Hello, my name is Jill Haskin, and I am with Shasta County Health and Human Services Agency. I'm standing in for Carrie Schutte, our county PIO today. We will start first with the numbers. As of Tuesday afternoon, we have 12,257 total confirmed cases, 10 people hospitalized in Shasta County, including one in the intensive care unit. We have about 157 people in isolation and an estimated 167 people that are currently active cases. We had 9 confirmed cases on Sunday and 40 on Monday, and have an available regional ICU capacity of 34.9%. So we're still in good shape there. We've received 549 newly received negative tests, total tests 210,114, and we are currently at 226 deaths. With us today, we have Robin Schurig, the Director of the Public Health Branch of the Health and Human Services Agency, and Dr. Karen Ramstrom, our County Health Officer. Robin, would you like to get us started?
Sure, thank you. I want to start with our latest case rate and test positivity. We continue to be assigned to the red tier, along with only 9 other counties. None are in the purple, and meanwhile, 35 are in the less restrictive orange tier, and 13 are in the least restrictive yellow tier. Our case rate decreased from 8.7 daily cases per 100,000 population last week to 8.0 this week, and that is our adjusted rate. It was adjusted down because we have a higher testing volume than the state average. Our unadjusted rate was 8.5. Our test positivity increased from 2.9% last week to 3.4% this week, but again, that is still pretty low. And again, as long as our test positivity stays at or below 8%, then a case rate of less than 6 would qualify us for the orange tier. We would need to meet that criteria for 2 weeks in a row before we would move to the orange. On to our vaccination rates, the denominator changed this week because of 12 to 15 year olds being authorized to receive Pfizer. So now when we talk about the eligible population, we mean anyone age 12 or older. The latest data from the state shows that our rate of at least one dose among the eligible population is 42.1%. compared to the statewide rate of 60.8%. Again, those figures both went down slightly from last week, but it's because the denominator increased. So we still have more people vaccinated this week compared to last, and I'll share those numbers as well. The number of doses administered to Shasta County residents is now at 102,958. The number of Shasta County residents fully vaccinated is 48,351, which is 31.8% of the eligible population. And there are an additional 15,543 people partially vaccinated, or 10.2% of the eligible population. So that's a total of 63,894 people who've received at least one dose, or 42.1%, which makes us the 12th least vaccinated of the state's 58 counties. That, combined with us having one of the highest case rates in the state, makes it important for us to continue to encourage people to get vaccinated, address any access barriers they may have, and help them get their questions answered and their concerns addressed. We encourage people to visit ShastaReady.org for information, including links to reputable sources of information, and to talk with your healthcare provider if you're still unsure. We're also encouraging people to continue to be vigilant about masking and distancing. The CDC released some new guidance last week about masking, particularly for fully vaccinated people, but California has decided to stick with their existing guidance for now, and they plan to follow CDC guidance beginning on June 15th. Until then, masks are still required in indoor settings, regardless of vaccination status, except if you're getting together in a private setting like someone's home, in which case vaccinated people can get together with other vaccinated people without masking or distancing, and they can get together with unvaccinated people from one other household without masking or distancing, as long as those people are not at high risk of severe illness from COVID. Outside of those private settings, masking is still required indoors unless you're in a vehicle by yourself or only with other members of your household, or when you're working in a room by yourself, regardless of vaccination status. Outdoors, masking is not required for fully vaccinated people unless you're at a crowded event, but masking is still required for unvaccinated people anytime you're not able to maintain 6 feet of distance from people from other households. And as a reminder, masks are still required and will likely continue beyond June 15th to be required nationwide in certain places like healthcare facilities and on public or mass transportation and in transportation hubs such as airports. Also, in workplaces, employers will need to continue to follow OSHA standards, which still currently require masking. While there could be changes to that requirement later this week, the mask requirement will not be going away altogether at this point. Rather, it will be dependent on the vaccination status of staff. And I'll turn it over to Dr. Ramstrom for some more information on vaccination.
Hello, everyone. Today, I want to talk a bit about vaccinating our young people. And why is this important right now? Youth represent a growing proportion of COVID-19 cases in Shasta County, teens in particular. This is consistent with national trends as youth have renewed participation in athletics and other recreational activities this spring, resulting in more COVID-19 exposure and infections. Fortunately, we have had few hospitalizations among children over the course of the pandemic in Shasta County, but the majority of our youth with COVID have had symptoms and are a key source of infection in households. The good news, as Robin alluded to, is that last week the FDA extended the emergency use authorization and the CDC approved use of Pfizer vaccine for individuals 12 years and up, lowering the prior age cutoff of 16 years. In addition, the American Academy of Pediatrics and the American Academy of Family Physicians have both announced their recommendations that adolescents age 12 and older get vaccinated against COVID-19. In light of this newly eligible group, I thought I would share the findings of the clinical trials that were reviewed by the FDA and CDC and that led to the recommendations for use among youth age 12 and up. In terms of safety, Pfizer and BioNTech conducted trials in more than 2,000 adolescents aged 12 to 15, with half of them randomized to receive vaccine and half to receive placebo. The most common side effects were pain at the injection site, fatigue, headache, chills, muscle pain, fever, and joint pain, similar to trials in older teens and adults, with most of those symptoms transient, resolving within a couple of days. No serious events were determined to be related to the vaccine, and no deaths were reported. There were also no reports of blood clots, serious allergic reactions, or Bell's palsy. In terms of efficacy, vaccine efficacy for this age group was 100%. Among just over 1,000 vaccine recipients, there were no cases of COVID-19, while 16 cases were reported among the placebo group. An immunogenicity analysis in 190 participants also showed their response was even better than the response for those aged 16 to 25 years, so that's good news. In terms of vaccine administration, the vaccine for adolescents is a two-dose series, 21 days apart, the same as for adults. Parental consent is necessary and can typically be provided either in person, which is preferred, or in writing based on the policy of the vaccine provider. The vaccine should not be given to anyone with a history of severe or immediate allergic reaction to a previous dose of this vaccine or to components of the vaccine. So what are the benefits of vaccinating our youth? You know, in addition to protecting our young people and families from experiencing COVID-19 illness, this is an opportunity to help our kids safely resume activities that they miss. You know, it means a fun and healthy summer full of recreational activities and social events, maybe a summer job. Fully vaccinated people can avoid quarantine if exposed to someone with COVID-19 and therefore continue to enjoy summer activities. It also means protecting people around you, whether family members or people in the community who might be medically high risk or work in vulnerable settings like a skilled nursing facility. And vaccinating our youth now prepares them to go back to school next year protected. Where can kids get vaccinated? There are several options in Shasta County, and we suggest that you go to MyTurn and indicate your youth's age to find a clinic with appointments, or check out ShastaReady.org for a list of upcoming vaccination dates at Rite Aid pharmacies, including on the weekend. And there's also a list there on Shasta Ready of additional vaccine providers that carry the Pfizer vaccine. I'm also excited to share information about a new vaccine location for both youth and adults. Starting this Friday, May 21st at 3:00, a Pfizer vaccine clinic will be initiated ongoing at the Reading Senior Center Optum location on Benton Drive in Reading. Walk-in appointments are welcome, and people can also sign up and make an appointment on myturn.gov. The Senior Center will be open Friday through Tuesday from 10 a.m. to 7 p.m. And we encourage people to check those appointments out on MyTurn. Lastly, as Robin mentioned, we encourage people who have questions or concerns about the vaccine to speak with their healthcare provider or other trusted source. That's all I have today. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Ramstrom. And an additional thing about the Senior Center, they will be closed on Memorial Day, so it will not be available for COVID shots that or vaccines that day. That concludes our briefing for today. The next briefing will be shared at 11 a.m. next Wednesday. Please enjoy your week.